good morning, everyone. I see y'all logging in.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Awesome, awesome. Well, good morning, everyone. One, I want to thank you guys this morning. You know, I really appreciated the conversation that we were able to have yesterday. And I appreciate you all giving us the opportunity to change up our schedule. I know we're used to doing market updates on Tuesday to kind of get the week started. And yet, you know, with everything going on, yesterday was a much needed conversation. And we're going to continue that conversation. And I just truly appreciate the vulnerability, the open-mindedness, you know, the community that all of you showed in being willing and being open to have a conversation that might not feel the most comfortable, right? And I also, you know, want to make sure that we also, you know, we honor and respect everything that's going on in the world right now, and we move forward together. And so I did want to come back and make sure that I'm sharing our market update with you this morning. We always want to get started with some pump up music. I had the tiger blasting, you know, this morning. That's, I'm telling you guys, that is my new Alexa wake up morning song to kind of get me in the mood. That's an anchor. So aside from, before we go into the market update, right, remember, how do you guys anchor yourselves? So a lot of you just got done with bold, right? And I am bold, and the bold wristband that a lot of you wear, that's an anchor. It's that reminder that gets us back into a positive frame of mind, right? That gets us back into that mode. And so those things that we kind of create a repetition around, that we make that our check-in, right? It's gonna reaffirm that energy and reaffirm that state. So thank you guys for letting me get started with that. I want to jump in right into the market update because I know that there's a lot of info to cover this morning, and I'm going to go into, let's see, let me get into screen share mode. There we go. Awesome. Okay, can everybody see the real estate market? Thumbs up. I got my thumbs up. Yep. Everybody can see it okay? All right. Awesome. I got a couple of thumbs up there. Perfect. Okay, great. So to get started right away, again, right, when we start going through these numbers, what we really want to have that understanding of is where are we right now, you know, in comparison to where we were, what is this looking like? And what is the implications that this has in our market? So we understand how to go forward and talk with our clients, right? And talk with our clients. So as always, the first thing I want to take a look at is going to be the showing rates. Now, if you remember when we talked about this last week, one of the things that I said is that I was pretty positive that we were going to get back to or slightly surpass regular showing levels again. Right. So if we recall, the blue line here is our 2019 weekly average of showings by week. The yellow line is our showings for the same time period, but in 2020. And one of the things that we've been going over week by week is we saw a really big dip when the pandemic hit back in March. And that slowly has been going back up as we've continued to see more buyers gain confidence and want to move forward, as we've continued to see, you know, the reins around the pandemic tighten up a little bit. Now, I'm going to note, so a couple things, right? Remember, we had a little bit of a drop. And when we talked about it is, again, we want to inspect what we're expecting about what's going on with the market. So we had seen that drop during the holiday weekends, right? We saw those drops during the holiday weekends. Now, if we look at last week, we were only slightly, right, slightly below where we were at the same time last year. So we've kind of hit that peak again. And then this week, as we go through that, this week we hit it, right? We're literally, we hit it. So if you look at this little piece here, we hit it and then we popped back down slightly. Right, we popped back down slightly. Now, I'll note, just on the basis of what we're seeing right now with a couple things, right? with the civil unrest that's going on and the curfew, I do anticipate that when we're looking at this again next week, we're gonna have a slight decrease, right? So even though we've seen this go up within the past couple of weeks, even though we've seen more buyers out on the market, we probably are gonna see a slight decrease because we have less working hours in the day, right? And people are wanting to stay home right now with everything going on. So I wanna be open about that, because that's one of the things that's probably gonna impact the showings and the trends within this next week. Aside from everything that's going on though, we are seeing this kind of, the demand that had really been bottlenecked is coming back up, right? People wanna be out there seeing properties right now. They're wanting to move forward. Those that are more stable, those that are in positions where they have the ability to move forward, we're seeing them really wanting to come out and view those properties. And that's why this pent up demand has really, looks like we're about that place where it's been released. And yet with everything going on, it's probably gonna tighten for a little bit, and then it'll likely go back up again. So that's a little bit on the showings. Now this week, where our window has been broadened a little bit. We've been looking at that 8-week window pre-COVID from January 27th to about March 22nd. And now we're looking at the weekly averages for the COVID impact window that's been from about March 23rd to this past week, right, to June 1st. And so going through that a little bit, I wanna compare this, a couple items that we're gonna look at from last week to this week. And then we're gonna talk about some of the trends and what is being forecasted based on just some of the conversations that we've been having, right? So as we recall, the median for sale price during pre-COVID, so that first quarter of the year, right, we saw the median for sale price at about a weekly average of $554,600. Now, the past couple weeks, this has steadily, right, this has either steadily increased or maintained to lift the weekly average. So last week, that 9-week window, the home price that we were seeing on average for new inventory that was coming on the market was about $575,000. Which brought the 9-week average up to 559. We look at this week, the average has stayed at 575. So properties that have been for sale in the last week, they've stayed at about 575, right? It's brought the 10-week average up slightly to about 560,600. Now, again, we've got more people that are out there looking at properties, right? We've got a lot more people out there looking at properties. We've seen that demand go up, and we know that supply is still a little low. So we're going to go into that when we start getting in a little bit more into the pricing. The median under contract. So the week of 527, what we had seen was that it had popped up. The week before that, the median price point had been at 600 for under contract. The week before, it was at 620, right? This week, it dropped back down to about 600. Right, it dropped back down to about 600, and the weekly, it's still higher than it was, right? So our weekly average moved to about 595, right? Our weekly average moved to about 595. In comparison to the 8-week average being about 603 at 300 pre-COVID. So prices have kind of lined up, but we're not seeing too much fluctuation right now, at least not increasing on a week over week basis. Right, we're not seeing that much of an increase just yet. The under contract is still slightly lower than the average was pre-COVID during that 8-week window, right? And yet it's not jumping up too much. So you might be seeing that as you're meeting with your clients, you might be seeing multiple offer situations still, right? Just on the basis of demand, there may be some concessions that are happening, right? What I think from the conversations that I've been having with a lot of you, we're still seeing multiple offer situations, but whereas, you know, at the tail end of last year, we were seeing multiple offer situations where we were seeing properties up to 20, 25, even 30K above the listed price. Right now, we're not seeing that concession, that is much competition. Is there's multiple offers, and yet most of them are still kind of around the for sale price. Right, most of them are still kind of around that for sale price. And then through the transaction, is where we're seeing certain concessions come up as interest rate issues come up, as different pieces come up as it pertains to the home. We're seeing a lot more requests for repairs throughout the transaction, right? And what is that? That's the mindset of a buyer that feels that they think that the market is down, right? They think that the market is down. And so they have a nervousness around overspending on the properties. And yet we're seeing prices pretty stable across the board. So that's not really the case as much so right now, right? Let's look at the inventory. So when we look at the total inventory sold last week, right? The week of 5/27, we had seen 555 homes sold in Los Angeles County, right? 555 homes sold in Los Angeles County. That had brought our 9-week average up to about 527, still about 41, a little bit over 41% down from where we were pre-COVID, which was that 897 homes were selling on average per week in that 8-week window before COVID. So the total homes being sold are still down a little bit. That it went down slightly this past week. We had 514 homes that sold last week in Los Angeles County. The per week average is about 525. We're still down at almost 41.5%, right? So we're still seeing that. I'll be honest, you guys, that may drop a little bit this week as well, right? That may drop a little bit this week as well, because of curfews, because of these different things that are taking place, the sales, we may be seeing a little bit more extensions, right? Extensions of closing. So if you had anything that was scheduled to close this week, then you want to make sure that you're bulletproofing your transaction, right? Talking to the team. And by team, I mean, hey, if there's questions, if there's things that are coming up on the transactions that you need our coaching support on, give me a call, give Jason a call, give Rich a call so that we can work with you on that. If you're not sure, you know, if you should be talking an extension or you don't know what questions to ask the lenders and the escrow, you want to have that conversation with them, right? On any of your pending closings, is are we still on schedule or are we looking at anything being extended? We want to have more of that insight, right? We want to make sure that we're managing that. In terms of new inventory, so homes that hit the market, this also dropped within the past week, right? This also dropped within the past week. So the week of 5/27, kind of that last week, essentially almost that a little bit before that end of the month, we saw 1,051 homes hit the market. Still down, our 9-week average was still down about 34% in comparison to, we had about 1,319 homes hitting the market on a week by week basis during that 8-week period pre-COVID. Now, this past week, we dropped from 1,051 to 981 homes. 981 homes hit the market last week in Los Angeles County, right? 981 homes, which moved our average to about 881. This is actually the first time in about 3 weeks, right? In about 3 weeks that we've dipped below 1,000 or more homes hitting the market on a week by week basis, right? So again, we want to inspect what we expect. Does that mean that people are not wanting to sell? What does that mean and how does that pertain to our clients? A couple of things. So inventory is still tight, which is why prices are maintaining, right? So that's a conversation that we need to have with our sellers that are on the fence, right? Is there still demand? There's not enough supply to meet the demand, right? There's not enough supply out there to meet the demand of buyers that we have going on. And yet what we're probably seeing, a couple of things. I know a couple of you have told me, hey, you know, I have a listing that's gonna be hitting in the market, but now they wanna wait a week, right? Or now they wanna wait a little bit to list it. And that's okay. What we may wanna look at is, can we have it as a registered listing? So we go by clear cooperation agreement, is it possible, and would the client be open to doing a registered listing, right? Where we're in that period of time where you're still able to show it to buyers with whom you have a buyer agreement, right? With buyers with whom you have a buyer agreement, or can you market it internally in the office? Are they okay with that, right? Is that something, or are they completely wanting to stay off the market right now? So we wanna be having those conversations. You know, the inventory, we've been on an upward trajectory the past 3 to 4 weeks. And in all honesty, I mean, what we know to be true is that the sentiment that's in the air right now might be affecting people putting a little bit of a pause on moving their homes forward, right? Moving that forward. So right now, we just really want to continue to get into conversation with our sellers, with our clients, with our buyers. And I'll note, you guys, right now, again, you know, we've been talking about doing the care call within the past, you know, few weeks, the past few months, honestly. And right now, we just, again, when we're making those calls, when we're having those conversations, we want to come from three places. We want to come from care. We want to come from compassion. And we also want to come from common sense, right? As we need to be coming from common sense as well. And being careful on how we're opening a conversation if somebody's not ready to talk about this, right? We just want to be vigilant on that. But again, that's kind of what we're seeing within the past week. So let me end the screen share really quickly. I'm going to grab two things real quick. Okay. Uh-oh, where did my... There we go. Okay, y'all see me? Perfect. So a lot of information. Let me pop open. I see the chat. So the difference between the standalone number and the number in parentheses. Okay, let me share that screen real quick so I can show you that really quickly one more time. Okay, so the number in parentheses is going to be the average price point within the past week. So the average price point was $575, right? Last week. The average under contract price was $600 last week. 514 homes were sold last week in Los Angeles County. 981 homes hit the market last week in Los Angeles County. That's the number in the parentheses. So thank you for asking that, Jennifer. The second number, this number that's the standalone and this number that's the standalone here, that's the per week average within that period of time, right? So across 8 weeks pre-COVID, the median for sale price was $554,600. Within the last 10 weeks post-COVID, or as it relates to COVID impact, the median price point has been $560,600, which is up 1%, a little bit more than 1% from $554,000, right? Under contract, same thing, this one has dropped, right? 603,300 was the per week average in the period of time pre-COVID. The 595 is the per week average in this post-COVID period of time. Again, we go into total inventory sold. Pre-COVID, we were seeing approximately 897 homes hit the market. That was the average in that 8 week window. 525 homes on average within the past 10 weeks, right? On a week by week basis. And then again, on that 8 week average of new inventory, that was 1,319 homes that hit the market on a weekly basis on average within that 8 week window, right? Within this post COVID impact, this 10 week window, we've seen on average within the past 10 weeks, about 881 homes hitting the market, right? So I hope that answers that question as well, but I just wanted to make sure we have that clarity. And as always, I will make sure that I post out, you know, that I post these graphics for you in the PDF for download, and that'll be up on the site today so that you guys are able to download that so that you guys can utilize this within, you know, as you're talking with your clients, as you're talking with your teams, as you're having those conversations. Again, remember guys, it's not going to take us, you know, we read through this and it doesn't just take us that one time. We want to continue, you know, delving into this information, because we're learning to kind of inspect the numbers. And really what we're looking to do is we can always show a client the numbers, but we want to give them an understanding of it, right? Jovita, in terms of the office inventory, let me confirm that. I will double check that for you, because I don't want to give you misinformation, and I have not reviewed that today. So thank you for asking that piece as well. Right now, guys, you know, we talked about this a little bit yesterday, and I want to go back to that page in shift, right? So if you have your shift books, or this is a great page to bookmark for later, I'm jumping really quickly to page 94, right? 94 is part of the conversation where the chapter where he talks about the idea of getting to the table where we talk about lead conversion, right? Where we talk about lead conversion. Now, what I want to remind you is that when we talk to the people that are in our network, and we know, and we've been talking about this, that the database, that our sphere of influence, that's our biggest opportunity, right? We want to do people that we know, like, and trust. And that's where our biggest opportunity zone is at. And we know when we're out there, excuse me, and we're having conversations with people, we want to capture their information, right? If we're meeting them for the first time, we want to capture that information. That's part of lead generation. We need to connect with them. And then we get to the conversion. But when we talk about this idea of connecting on page 94, and I said this yesterday, I'm going to repeat it again, because I think it's really important, and it's important to understand how this comes into play with everything that's going on right now, right? Is Gary says on page 94 under connecting, the fundamental theme of connecting is curiosity. To know who someone is, to understand their wants and needs, and to become aware of their worries and concerns. You are investigating, not selling. You are investigating, not selling. You are a consultant who genuinely wants to understand their situation and offer help if needed. Your goal is to generate trust and build confidence. First yours, and then theirs, right? And then theirs. It's your chance to show them what it feels like to work with you. It's your chance to show them what it feels like to work with you. So what does that mean, right? Especially right now is we've had a conversation around forbearances, which we know is definitely a worry and concern. And yet many of our clients, many of the people in our networks have different worries and concerns right now. And so I want to repeat this, and I really, you know, I want this to be something that you guys hold on to and that you remember as you're out there talking with your clients, is that we are a consultant who genuinely wants to understand. It's about coming from contribution. It's about being authentic in creating and connecting the relationships that we have, right? It's about the service before sales, the humanity before sales, right? We want to make sure that we're being genuine in how we're talking with our people, and just being, again, coming from care, right? Coming from compassion. He goes on further to say, during the connect step, things will feel like they're slowing down for just a moment. And that's good. The fundamental philosophy of connecting is people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. In other words, this isn't where you tell and sell your way to success, but where you ask and listen your way into their head and into their heart. When you connect with someone, you demonstrate that you care. The two tools you'll use are your mouth and ears, but not equally. You have two ears and one mouth for a reason, and this is when you use them accordingly. You will ask and then listen and listen. Then you'll ask again and then listen and listen. Be sure to take notes. It guarantees you will remember what they said, and if you happen to be with them, they'll see that you care. And just when you think that you should talk, ask and listen some more. You don't talk your way into trust relationship with someone. You ask and listen your way. Right? And I think that's important, right? That's really important as we're having our conversations. Further on page 95, it goes into the six connection questions. Who are they? What do they want or need to do? Where do they want or need to do it? Why do they want or need to do it? When do they want or need to do it? And how do they plan to do it? So I think the important piece right here is that, you know, when you're having the conversation, when you're calling your clients, am I saying, hey, don't ask for the business? No, that's not what I'm saying, right? I know that our livelihoods are dependent on us moving our businesses forward and being able to find and secure potential sales. And there are absolutely people out there that need to sell right now or need to buy right now, right? The demand is there. That's why we're seeing, that's what the numbers are showing us. And yet the conversation that we have with people, I want to encourage you that as you're having those conversations, remember to start with the connecting questions. Start with the connecting questions. Come from care and compassion. And if they open the door and you can open the door into the conversation around real estate and it feels like authentic, genuinely, it's a good moment to have that conversation, then great, we can move the ball forward there, right? And if it feels like they're not mentally in a space to have that conversation right now, then I just want to remind you to be respectful about that. You know, make notes, come from that care and compassion and come back to that conversation later, right? Use the tools that you have, because again, what does it say here? It says, be sure to take notes. It guarantees you will remember what they said. And if you happen to be with them, they'll see that you care. Why? Because we also need to make sure that these notes and these tools, that we're putting them into the system, right? We're putting them into the database so that we have context when we come back to the conversation, right? So I just, I wanted to start there because I wanted to just kind of remind us that you know, we're in a different time right now, right? We're in a really different time right now. And so we wanna be aware and acknowledge that as we're going through our day-to-day business operations. We've been talking about this, right? It's business as usual in an unusual way, right? In an unusual way, we're changing the way that we do things a little bit. We're being open with our clients. We're giving them the support that they need. We're acting as consultants and not just salespeople. We're here to help them and guide them forward. So with that, I want to just kind of close out. I know we have a couple other things on the schedule today. You guys are jumping on the next coaching call. I know we have that. I believe we have Ignite Elementals today as well. So make sure if you have that on your schedule that you're jumping in, that's going to be on Zoom, and we'll be moving forward with the class of schedules. One thing, yesterday our call ran a little bit longer than we anticipated, and yet it was a conversation that needed to happen. And so Jason, I know he posted in the hub. Unfortunately, I know there was some issues on the scheduling. Tech happens, you know, mistakes happen. So we apologize for that, but he will be doing contracts class tomorrow, and he's going to go over the updates on the property entry and disclosure form. I know there's a lot of questions that you guys have had around that. We're going to go through those full updates tomorrow, on contracts class. So there'll be a lot of information there. And then a couple of the other forms that are new that have recently been released. So make sure that if you need updates on that, if you need information, that'll be tomorrow at 10. And then a couple pieces just on serving, you know, on serving today so that we can end the day on the positive note. Dave Ramsey says, at the end of the day, we are not selling, we are serving, right? At the end of the day, we are not selling, we are serving. Tom Skrider says, facts tell, stories sell. Lori Beth Jones says, people will remember stories long after they have forgotten your bullet points. And, you know, a couple other pieces. Always give without remembering and always receive without forgetting. Always give without remembering and always receive without forgetting, Brian Tracy. Harvey McKay says, treat your customers as though you were their most dedicated employee and consultant, ready to serve them every way so they feel your company is practically a division of their company. The last one, and as you go out today, I hope that this is the one you hold to heart, right? As you go out and you have the conversations today, I hope this is the one that you take with you as you're calling through your clients, as you're calling through anyone out there that you're doing your lead generation, your lead servicing. Christopher Chansky says, make sure the best thing to happen to your customer today is you. Make it a great day, you guys. Happy Wednesday. Bye, everyone.